Welcome, folks. Thanks for joining me today for this webinar session. By way of sort of introductions initially, so my name is Chris, I'm going to be your presenter today. So I am the training director for SEO here at Jellyfish. So I lead our training courses for our SEO proposition. Just so you know, a little bit of some background information about me. I've been working in SEO about 10, almost going on 11 years now. Been working at Jellyfish since joined in 2013. I'm now a dedicated member of the training team. Worth noting that for a large part of my career in SEO has been spent actually working with clients, consulting on campaigns, working on the agency side of Jellyfish, actually working with clients. And in my role, actually within the training team, I also am responsible for leading the SEO campaign for the training website. So I talk the talk with regards to SEO, also walk the walk still to a degree. So yeah, that's me. So just a couple of things in terms of sort of etiquette for the webinar. In terms of if any of you have questions as we go through the session, we will have time at the end dedicated to questions, but do feel free, if you have any questions as we go through, drop them into the chat so you kind of remember those things that you want to ask, and then I can pick those up at the end and kind of see what's coming in as we go through. Just as you have at the moment, keep yourselves on mute. Just cuts down on any background noise for me and for everybody else. Makes the session more enjoyable. Not seeing anybody's video at the moment. If you have got video, you want to kind of turn it on. So it always makes things a little easier for me when I can actually kind of see who I'm talking to. If you want to do that, then great. If not, then no worries. So yeah, let's get cracking. So title of the webinar today, what can we learn about SEO from Google's fight against disinformation? So why are we, to begin with, why are we talking about disinformation today? And basically, largely because kind of these conversations around fake news and the whole issue around misinformation on the web has become particularly prominent over the past few years. Clearly, some significant kind of people in the space talking a lot about fake news. Fake news in itself has become an item and really significant in the news agenda. Now, that has put a lot of pressure on both publishers and creators of content for the web, both kind of news organizations and brands who are creating content, etc. But it's also put a lot of pressure on the main sort of digital networks, whether that be the search engines such as Google, whether it be social media platforms, etc., to try and make sure that they're not promoting and amplifying misinformation on the web. Clearly, when we have cases of fake news, disinformation appearing on the internet, you know, that can have serious consequences. You know, it's an obvious example at the moment, going through a global pandemic. Misinformation that's out there about the pandemic and the way people should respond to it is potentially impacting people's behavior and perhaps leading people to make some poor choices about their own health and the health of other people. So it's an example of how disinformation can actually have a very direct impact on people's lives in a negative way. But I think also in a broader sense, just the amount of talk around fake news, etc., over the past few years has actually sort of led to an erosion of confidence in content on the web. And I think that's kind of damaging for us. I think it's leading to an erosion in trust in our political, social institutions, governmental institutions, and that's obviously not great for any democracy. Just you know, as an example, kind of an interesting thing that came out of the general election that we had in the UK last year at the end of 2019, and there was a survey done, some research done as part of that. And one of the things that came out of that, and the stats that came out of that, was that around about half of all UK adults believe that the major political parties in the UK had been spreading fake news as part of that election process. Now, whether or not they were doing that or weren't doing that is kind of a conversation for somewhere else. I think the interesting thing is just that perception of whether they were or whether they weren't. Half of the UK population suspected that they were, essentially they were distrusting the information they were getting from political parties, major institutions that you should be able to really, really trust. So specifically, what does this have to do with SEO? So as I've kind of already mentioned, this whole kind of conversation has put a lot of pressure on distributors of content as well as creators of it. And clearly the sort of major digital networks, search engines, social media campaigns fall very much into that. And specifically, we start to think about Google and we start to think about SEO. Google does take that responsibility very seriously. And that they've done a lot in recent years to improve their processes to try and make sure that they are not promoting with their products, whether that be Google Search, whether it be Google News, YouTube, advertising, they're not promoting misinformation, disinformation, and fake news. So one of the things I'm focusing on mainly within this session is this white paper that was produced by Google, published by Google in 2019. This paper on how Google fights disinformation. And within this, Google set out the strategy on how they're actually tackling the intentional spread of information across those products online. So it's kind of really useful information then that we can look at. So one of the first things, that Google does within this document is just actually set out in broad terms what their approach is to sort of tackling this problem of disinformation, where they say broadly that's based around a framework of three strategies. First of all, making quality counts in the ranking systems and making sure the ranking processes are only showing good quality, accurate, truthful content. Also counteracting malicious actors, making it more difficult for them to promote content and giving users more context when they're finding information to help them judge the accuracy and truthfulness of content. Now, within this session, we're focused on SEO. So the main part we're going to be focusing on is that first element, that idea of Google making quality count in their ranking systems. So that leads us initially onto the question of, how does Google measure quality and what can we learn from this process? And I think it's worthwhile saying at this point, obviously within this session, we're kind of looking at and we're talking about disinformation in sort of news content, editorial content. But I think it's important to note that the things that Google are doing in terms of essentially making themselves better at recognizing good quality content is being applied across all content on the web and all search. Although the focus here might be on news and editorial content, basically, we can kind of take these lessons and apply those to all the content that we may be working with online. Okay, so one of the first things Google has to say in this white paper is basically just pointing out that when they're assessing content on the web, they're using algorithms, they're not using humans to determine the ranking of content they show to users. Shouldn't come as any great surprise to anybody, certainly who's working in the SEO field. Just go on to stress that no individual at Google ever makes determinations about the position of an individual web page within the Google search results. They go on to sort of elaborate on that and talk about their algorithms and the way that their algorithms are geared towards ensuring the usefulness of their services, the content they're promoting essentially, as measured by user testing. So this is kind of an important concept. Google is using a lot of user testing, user data to influence their algorithmic processes. Google are not interested in fostering the ideological viewpoints of any one individual or any side of the argument. See a lot of debate about kind of how balanced Google may or may not be, but this is at least is what Google are telling us. And they kind of go on further within the white paper to state that their ranking systems do not identify the intent or factual accuracy of any given piece of content. And this is kind of a really interesting point from Google. Essentially, you know, what they're saying is when they're evaluating any particular page on the web and they're evaluating content, again, they're making no judgment. They're not actually even trying to understand whether or not that individual piece of content, that individual web page, is factually correct, accurate, etc. Google has no real means of doing that. It's a really tough thing to do if you think about it for an algorithm to identify. So however, what they are doing, their algorithms are specifically designed to identify sites with, as they term it, a high indicia of expertise, authority, and trustworthiness on the web. So then what they're going on to say is systems do not make, again, subjective determinations about the truthfulness of web pages, but rather focus on measurable signals that correlate with how users and other websites value, again, same phrase, expertise, trustworthiness, or authoritativeness of content on the web, of individual web pages. So to give an example of kind of sort of thing Google might mean by that, if we imagine a piece of content on the web, a web page that's dedicated, let's say, to tax regulations, and there's a web page that's talking about this year's kind of tax regulations, maybe personal allowances, this type of thing. What Google are saying is they're not looking at the precise information on that page, you know, tax bans, personal allowances, and making any judgment as to whether or not those actual kind of data points are correct or not. What they're using is correlating signals to determine how likely it is that piece of content is accurate or it's trustworthy. So in this case, like, some of the signals they're probably using are probably around sort of recency of content. If you have a piece of content on the web that's 5 years old and Google can see it was published 5 years ago, and they can see there's been no significant updates to that piece of content, specifically discussing tax legislation, Google are kind of going to make the judgment it's highly likely, pretty much inevitable in this case, that piece of content is no longer accurate, no longer representing the current situation. So those correlating signals are kind of not there to suggest that piece of content is going to be accurate. So they're going to be rewarding newer content, content that's been updated recently, and other kinds of signals around recency. So just in summary of that bar, Google is essentially evaluating content quality as measured by user testing and based on the expertise, trustworthiness, and authoritativeness of a web page, not by making subjective evaluations on individual pieces of content. So we'll look at sort of each of those things individually. So we'll start with this idea of user testing. What does Google mean when it talks about measured by user testing? And again, I think one of the sort of interesting things about this white paper that was published last year is it was actually kind of the first time that I'd seen Google talk in terms of sort of actual numbers, in terms of just how much user testing they are actually doing and how much user testing is influencing the ranking algorithms. So the white paper states in 2017, Google conducted more than 200,000 user-focused experiments that resulted in 2,400 changes to search. And actually, since this white paper, Google have been a bit more open with type of information. We can actually find data in 2019 now within the Google How Search Works documents that you can find on the web by searching. So in 2019, that figure had increased from 200,000 2 years earlier to more than 460,000 user-focused experiments that were being used to influence the way that Google's algorithms are working. That resulted in more than 3,600 improvements to search. So in a kind of broad sense, it's just kind of one of the things, a useful point worth making, is that, you know, when we start to think about Google, its algorithms, its ranking algorithms, sometimes we can get a little bit too focused, particularly in the SEO world, on Google's algorithms, its ranking processes, when Google's making updates to those, what exactly are they doing and trying to figure out exactly how it's scoring and ranking pages. What we have to understand, this is a constant ongoing process. As we see, actually multiple times a day, Google is making tweaks and changes to its algorithms. So from that point of view, spending too much time really trying to sort of understand exactly how Google's algorithms are functioning is a little bit of a waste of time, because it's a constantly sort of moving feast. So just talk a little bit more about this sort of idea of user testing. What does that mean from Google's point of view? broadly a couple of different ways that Google are doing that. On the one hand, and in the majority of the cases, what Google are talking about is user testing that's carried out in partnership with what's known as Google Search Raters. So essentially, Google employs people to evaluate their web results. So we have these search raters, and so part of our role is Google will give them maybe a search term, and they'll show them the search results for that search term, and they'll ask for feedback essentially as to the pages that they're seeing within those search results. Are they getting the types of results they would expect for that particular query? And also asking them to click through and look at the web pages included in that result and feed back in terms of quality and relevancy of that result to as to how effective do we think Google's search results have actually been. And that feedback from these user testers, and say this is majority of those 400,000 and odd tests that Google talk about, is part of this process. And the feedback they get from that is then used to update and improve the Google search algorithms. Important to note that that testing has no direct impact on any one individual web page. If you're in a situation where perhaps Google had asked some search raters to look at your particular web page, the feedback they give to Google is in no way going to directly kind of influence the rankings of your web pages. It's used in a general sense to help Google better understand what does good quality look like for users. The other thing Google are doing, as well as using those search raters, is actually looking at live user data, searches data. So they're running tests sort of live within the search results, and they're actually analyzing how we as users interact with those results. What type of results does Google see us clicking on for any particular search? When we click through to web pages following our journeys online, to try and evaluate what types of content when we have searched, do we seem to get what we're looking for from? What types of web pages do we seem to be engaged with? What types of web pages do we convert on? What types of web pages do we buy from? And that helps inform Google as to when somebody searches for certain terms, what was somebody looking for, and what the types of web pages seem to satisfy that particular search result. There's a lot of AI and machine learning as part of that process that is then influencing the Google algorithms directly. So a lot of what Google is doing these days in terms of trying to evaluate quality is based on that user data and user testing. So one of the things I'd say, if you're trying to understand, you know, what good quality looks like from Google's point of view, rather than sort of obsessing over this idea of sort of Google ranking factors and Google algorithms, actually a better strategy might be just to ask your users. Because at the end of the day, Google is making determinations based on feedback from users. So therefore, if you're keeping your users happy, it's highly likely that Google sort of recognizes those signals that are keeping users happy, and it's therefore likely that your content will perform better in search as well. So I think more sort of talking to users, more getting feedback from users as to the quality of your content is a really sort of useful approach. I think it's something that we don't necessarily do enough generally in the sort of digital marketing world. So plenty of people who are doing lots of sort of user testing, UX testing on their websites. In my experience, however, that tends to be a bit more focused on the way that users maybe navigate around your website, maybe how easy it is for users to discover content, the sort of taxonomy of your web pages, rather than being focused on that question actually of whether or not, when users have found your content, do they actually find it useful? Do they find it valuable? Do they think it's good quality? And a lot of that feedback, I think, is invaluable in terms of guiding our content policies. Okay, so let's move on to this question of expertise, trustworthiness, or authoritativeness of a web page. So again, if you've been working in SEO for a little while, done anything within SEO, you're probably reasonably familiar with this as the term expertise, authority, trustworthiness. It's something that Google's been talking about a lot. One of the places they talk about it is in this document you can see on screen at the moment. So we talked about those search raters that Google employ to evaluate the search results. Google actually produces a really thorough set of guidelines for those raters. It's a PDF of, I think, 164 pages that goes into a lot of detail in terms of what should those search raters be looking for when they're assessing the web results, how should they evaluate websites in terms of quality, and how should they score them, essentially. So there's actually quite a lot of useful information within that. It's worth reading. So whenever you've got time, it's worth to kind of go look at taking a look at that document in full. In terms of what that document has to say about quality, so Google talks about high quality pages having the following characteristics, four of them in this case. The first one of those, again, is referring back to this high level of expertise, authoritativeness, and trustworthiness. The three other points we'll come on to separately. So what exactly do we mean by expertise, authority, and trust? Get shortened down to EAT signals or EAT signals sometimes within the SEO world. So what do we mean by that? Now, kind of clearly, when we talk about expertise, authority, trustworthiness, these aren't in reality sort of three separate strands that are very sort of separate, we can keep apart. There's obviously a lot of crossover between what is expertise and what's authority and what's trust. But I think it is kind of helpful to try and sort of separate those out and try and think about the signals Google may be using in each of those cases. So broadly speaking, kind of within Jellyfish and the SEO teams here, I think the way we most commonly think about that is expertise comes from content signals on our web pages. Authority largely is gained by backlinks, other people linking to our web pages, which hopefully isn't an alien concept in terms of SEO. And trust is something that comes from a combination of brand awareness, good brand visibility, brand trust, and also security signals on our web pages. So let's look at each of these different elements in isolation. Okay, so we say that expertise signals are all about establishing yourselves as subject experts through content on your web pages. Okay, so hopefully we're all familiar with this quote, no man is an island. And the way I like to think about the web page is also no web page is an island. Okay, now this quote in full is actually from John Donne, no man is an island entire of itself, every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. So I like to kind of paraphrase this to think about web pages. My version of this for the web is no web page is an island entire of itself. Every page is one piece of the content, a part of the site as a whole. And essentially what I mean by this is when Google is evaluating your web page, they are not looking at that web page in isolation. They're trying to determine these signals of expertise, authority, and trust. It's not done solely by looking at your individual web page. When we talk about expertise, it's quite difficult to provide a lot of expertise signals based on one individual piece of content. And again, if we look at what the search rater guidelines say about authority, and here they talk about the characteristics of low quality pages and those that lack an appropriate level of EAT. The first thing they talk about there, the best example they give, is that the creator of the MC, which stands for main content, does not have adequate expertise in the topic of the main content. E.g., if you had a tax form instruction video made by someone who has no clear expertise in tax preparation. So essentially, we need to develop on the content on our site that essentially sets us as experts in our subjects. So how do we do that? We do that essentially by creating hubs of related content on our web pages. So whatever the topics and niches that we are working within, we need to create lots of good quality content on site that really demonstrates our expertise broadly within that subject, within that niche. As I said, the web pages do not sit in isolation. So ideally, what we may have is a hub of content that might sit within a particular section of your web pages. Not in every case, because you might have things like blog pages that sit somewhere else. But topically, they'll be linked. You'll be physically internally linking those pages together. And that just helps create this web of content that Google can see you have you hold on a particular topic. To give a specific example of that and how that may work, If I search, certainly I'm based in the UK, if I search for flights to New York, the first actually individual airline page that I see represented in the search results is British Airways and their product page, where you can actually go and find flights, book flights from London to New York. So that page in itself, it is a good pop quality page in and of itself, lots of good information on there, well designed, good user experience, etc. But those things alone, I don't believe, explain why that particular page ranks so well. What does help to explain it is actually when you start to look at the British Airways website, the way it's structured, they, for a lot of their destinations, particularly their key destinations, they have these destination hubs, these content hubs dedicated to particular destinations, in this case, New York. So we have a destination landing page for New York, which happens to sit kind of the top of that hierarchical structure for this part of the website. So we've got this New York page, this hub. Within that, yes, they have the flights page. The page is actually selling flights, where you can book flights. But they also have lots of other pages that sit around that. They've got a New York holidays page, where you can actually go and discover and book holidays to New York. And they've got a hotels page if you want to research and book hotels within New York. They've got a couple of, they've got some guide style content as well. So they've got a guide to visiting New York with kids. They've got a guide to shopping in New York. They've got a guide to driving in New York. So all this content that sits within this hub really starts to establish British Airways, in this case, as a subject matter expert when it comes to New York as a destination and travel to New York. And that is a good part of what helps that page rank. As ever, within SEO, there's always lots of different things that go into the mix that help a page rank. But in this case, I certainly feel that's one of the main factors, is the fact that British Airways have established themselves as subject matter experts in this particular case. Excuse me, I've inadvertently zoomed in on my slides there. Another way to think about this, of building up these expertise signals, is we want to make sure that when we are discussing a particular topic, or we have products, services in a particular niche or around a particular topic, we want to make sure that we understand what are all the things that people are searching for around that particular topic, and try and actually develop content that starts to answer all those different varied queries around it. One of the easiest ways to do this is actually to kind of look at Google itself, and particularly the elements that they often have within search results these days. You know, these people also ask elements that appear within the search results. So this is the example taken from that situation when I've searched for flights to New York. All these people also ask all these additional questions that Google are showing us are based on, it's based on Google data, it's based on historical data from Google. These are all questions that Google has seen people answer when they've shown an interest in New York and travel to New York. So this is information taken directly from users. Google know these are the things that users are interested in. So from that point of view, when you see these for the topics that you're discussing on your website, why wouldn't you almost kind of want to be creating content that actually addresses these questions? That's going to do a couple of things for you. First of all, it's going to broaden out your search opportunities, because you now have content on site that actually is relevant for these queries, that may start ranking for these queries and may start driving traffic where people actually search for these individual questions. It's also going to start to build up these signals of expertise again, because you as a provider of content have the answers that Google knows that users are looking for. Can't think of many better sort of expertise signals than that. It's also going to help you in terms of your kind of user journeys on your site, and hopefully in terms of conversions, because people are going to come to your site and rather having questions in mind that you don't answer and having to go off elsewhere to find answers to those, they're going to be able to find that information directly on your site, and hopefully people stick with you, stick with your pages and convert with you and buy from you, etc. And again, going back to the characteristics of high quality pages within the search rater guidelines, the second point there is this idea of, you know, pages should have a satisfying amount of higher quality main content. And again, this tactic is one of the ways of achieving that. I think just understanding on any particular page on your website what information it is the user is looking for, and making sure you provide that within the content. If you do that, you're going to be ticking those quality signals. Again, going to that specific example from British Airways, we can say they've done that with this flights to New York page, where they've got within that page a lot of this sort of FAQ style situation, information where they have identified those common queries and are providing answers to those directly within that page. Some of the common questions are also answered within other pages within that content hub as well, which also works. The reason I kind of know this works and this is something that impacts search performance is I've seen it work in reverse, where people have gone about this perhaps the wrong way. So this specific example is taken from a brand I've worked with in the past. And the situation here was, for a whole variety of reasons that we won't get into, that brand had a website relaunch. And as part of that process, they decided to cull a lot of the existing content that existed on their webpages. When they relaunched the site, it was a really slimmed down site. Now, interestingly, they didn't remove or change the actual sort of service product focus pages that they had on site. What they did was stripped out a lot of the other content that sat around those pages. So again, to give an example, if I think about one of the products that brand was selling, on the previous website, they had something like 100 other pages on site that discussed the same topic. Those were things like more granular subject pages or product pages where they went into more detail about the product, the service they were, services they were offering. It was editorial content like blogs around the topic. They had some guides around the subjects. They had case studies of things they'd worked on with clients in the past. So lots and lots of content around that particular subject, that particular niche. When they relaunched the site, all of that additional content was stripped away. And as this graph represents, when that new site went live, and this graph represents the visibility of those service pages that still existed on that site, the visibility just dropped away. They lost a lot of visibility in search. They lost a lot of rankings and lost a lot of traffic because of the fact those service pages no longer had the supporting content around them that helped to demonstrate, give those signals of expertise around that subject. So really important. Okay, so in terms of authority, as we said, authority, I believe, is largely sort of derived from link signals, backlink signals. Again, Google actually states this directly within the white paper, where it says Google's algorithms identify signals about pages that correlate with trustworthiness and authoritativeness. So I get blurred lines between those different strands. The best known of these signals is PageRank, which uses links on the web to understand authoritativeness. So PageRank, for anybody who may not be familiar with that term, is essentially just a mathematical process that Google uses in the background to calculate the authority of web pages based on the number of links pointing into those. So somebody's web page links to yours, they all have an aside PageRank. Some of that PageRank, essentially, in simple terms, passes through to your web page. So Google state, this is one of the key signals they're using in terms of determining authority. Clearly, if other users, and again, these are essentially user signals, other users on the web have decided that they rate your content highly enough that they want to potentially send their users through to it. So it's a key sort of authority signal. So when we think about links, you know, links have always been an important part of SEO, and they still are. Over the years, I've seen lots of people kind of argue that links are no longer as important as they used to be. Absolutely not the case, in my personal opinion. I think links are just as important as they have always been within SEO. The way they're important, the reasons they're important, have changed slightly. These days, it's much more about quality of links rather than quantity of links. So the types of signals and factors Google is looking at, the authority of domains that link to us. Clearly, if authority of domains link to us, some of that authority is going to pass through to our web pages. But also, really importantly, the relevancy of those linking domains to the subjects that we're building up those authority signals for. So that can either be because those domains that are linking to us discuss the same subject on a regular basis, or just that the individual pieces of content they're linking through deal with the topics that they're linking through to on our web pages. And also the recency of those links is really important as well. know, in terms of authority, when Google's thinking about a site or a page on the web, might have a lot of links, but if the last of those links was acquired 5 years ago, might be an indicator to Google actually that particular content is no longer as relevant as it used to be. So acquiring kind of fresh and new links to content and to your site is also a really important part of those authority signals. And again, to kind of give an example of how it works, if we think about this British Airways page and particularly the New York's destination section. Yeah, when you look at the backlink profile for this hub and for the flights page, they've got a lot of good authoritative links, some really authoritative sources from top-level sort of news publishers and government sites in a couple of cases. But also those links are really, really relevant as well. They tend to be talking about travel and sites dedicated to travel, New York as a destination. So those links have authority and they have relevance as well to this particular content hub. And also, again, it's kind of we get the value of having a lot of content within a content hub, because the way that linking is going to work is, yes, links to the individual flights to New York page are going to add value, but also if people linked to the guide to taking kids to New York, that's obviously going to drive authority to that particular page. But because it sits in a hub of content that's all interlinked, some of that authority is then going to pass on to other pages within that hub. So again, we gain strength from having these hubs of content. Okay, and finally, trust. So what is this trust element all about? I think in the first instance, one of the sort of major signifiers of trust comes down to brand awareness, good brand awareness and visibility. Probably unfortunately to a degree, there is a certain sort of bigger brand bias within search, within Google. Essentially just because, essentially it's a real trust signal for Google. If Google knows that people really recognize a particular brand, they're more likely to trust it, and it's therefore more likely that bigger brands will gain greater prominence in the search results. Probably lots of different ways that Google are measuring sort of brand awareness and brand visibility. One of the most obvious things for Google is how often do people actually search for your particular brand. The more Google sees people searching for a brand, the more it's going to increase those signals. More people are searching for it, therefore Google's going to assume it's a brand that is trusted by users. So essentially what this means is all of the other marketing activity that you may be doing, or the advertising that you may be doing, is, at least in an indirect way, contributing to the authority of your pages and essentially then the organic performance of your site as well. In terms of those sort of reputational signals as well, if we kind of look back again at what the search rater guidelines have to say about content quality, we see there's a couple of additional points that we've not discussed so far. So the first one of those is looking for websites that have satisfying website information and information about who is responsible for the website and satisfying customer service information. And again, that's important because, again, if we think about it from a user perspective, let's say we've got somebody coming to your website who's not familiar with your brand, a new user. What content do you have on site that's going to help them understand who you are as a brand, why they should trust you, why they should potentially purchase from you? So we've got to think about those signals. So things like basic about us content on the website becomes really important, because it's the place you can really explain to people who you are, as a brand, how long have you been in business, what's your expertise in a particular topic or niche, whether or not you're kind of members of particular professional organizations that may sort of give additional trust to yourselves and your brand, basically telling your brand story. And also Google goes on to talk about the positive website reputation for a website that's responsible for the main content on the page. So again, search raters are encouraged, as they're evaluating web pages and evaluating the search results, to actually look on the web and see where else brands are being talked about as a way of identifying the trustworthiness of that brand. It kind of leads you to think that perhaps there is some SEO benefits, some kind of ranking benefit, just in being talked about in other places in the web. We know that links are important, but potentially just being talked about in a positive way in other places on the web could actually be driving these sort of reputational signals and trust signals for Google. Also, as I said, a lot of these trust signals come down to good web security. Can Google trust your sites, particularly when it comes to giving you their personal details, the financial information, credit card details, etc. So making sure that our sites are secure, ideally served by the more current HTTPS protocol. We're serving our content in an encrypted way. We've got up-to-date security certificates, etc. All add elements of trust to your web pages, particularly if you're a transactional web page. Okay, so that's the kind of trust element of that. Now, an additional sort of layer that I want to add to this whole sort of conversation about expertise, authority, and trust is particular types of content. You may have heard of the phrase your money or your life content in relation to Google, the web, and to SEO. So what does that mean? Essentially, there are certain topics and subjects online that Google is going to hold to higher quality standards, because of the nature of the content, that content means that if Google's promoting inaccurate content, disinformation, fake news in relation to those subjects, they could actually have a materially negative impact on people, their lives, their health, their lifestyles, etc. And again, we can actually get a full list of these types of content, again, from those search rating guidelines. So again, well worth checking out. I'm not going to go through all of these individually, but what you really have to think about is whether or not any of your content, either your content as a whole or individual pieces of content on your website, may fall into any of these definitions. And if they do, you're actually going to have to work much harder to build up those signals of expertise, authority, and trustworthiness on your website. So as we can see, lots of different things covered in here, obvious things like health and safety, if you're giving health advice, selling health products, financial advice, financial products, but it's much, much broader than that. And these days go on to cover sort of news around international events, business, politics, science, content around groups of people, whether that be race, disability, age, nationality, other subjects such as fitness, nutrition, housing information, choosing a job, finding a job, choosing a college. All of these things, information is key to the way that people live their lives, and Google's going to hold that to a higher standard. So if you fall to that, you really have to work hard to establish those signals. Okay. Now, just before we kind of get to any questions that people may have, just one additional element I want to look at that Google talks about in this disinformation white paper is, yes, they talk about the things that they're doing to improve their own internal processes. But part of what Google is doing is actually working with external organizations to better improve qualities of content across the web. Okay. And there are a number of different organizations that Google talk about. What I want to focus on in particular is Google's involvement with the Trust Project, because I think there's some specific things we can look at. And particularly if you're a producer of news or editorial content, some things I think you need to take note of. So who are the Trust Projects? So taken from the Trust Project's own website, Trust Project is an international consortium of news organizations promoting standards of transparency and working with technology platforms such as Google to affirm and amplify journalism's commitment to transparency, accuracy, inclusion and fairness so the public can make informed news choices. And Google was a founder member of the Trust Project, have always been highly involved in it, and they financed it. Now, one of the most significant things the Trust Project have done is develop these 8 trust indicators. And we'll look at each of these individually, briefly, but we'll look at them individually. And the way that these are framed, they're presented as questions that users should ask themselves if they're trying to evaluate the trustworthiness of content on the web. Now, I'm not necessarily saying that all of these are aligned or correlate with sort of signals that Google are looking at in terms of their ranking processes, but given that Google has been so heavily involved in this, I don't think it's a massive leap of imagination to start thinking there's some things in here that might give us guidance as to things Google might be looking at in terms of the way they're judging quality of content. So first of all, the first point in this set of eight is best practices. So who funds the site? So if you're a news site, Google are kind of suggesting that you make sure you're giving information about who funds the site, what is the general sort of mission of the website, what your kind of standards and ethical guidelines around the process of gathering news and creating content, what happens in cases of, say, conflicts of interest, maybe individuals have covered a particular subject before. So making sure you're clear and transparent about these things is going to give a signal of trust to users, potentially maybe to Google as well. Journalistic expertise. Are you kind of clear about the people who are creating content, who actually devised individual pieces of content, who wrote it? Are there any details about the individual content producers, journalists, including maybe their contact information and areas of knowledge on the stories that they're working in? And again, this kind of makes you think on our own web pages, there might be real benefits to really promoting the people within our business and organizations who are producing content, talking about them individually, having profiles about those individuals on our web pages that talk about their skills, their experience, their qualifications, to be talking about particular subjects and particular matters. And again, that can become a trust signal. The type of work, what is it? Do you see story labels with clear definitions to distinguish opinion, analysis, or sponsored content on your web pages? And again, just kind of good practice to be thinking about whether or not we make clear we're transparent about the purpose of content and the type of content, and marking it appropriately. Citations and references. So guiding users to look at articles and analyze whether or not producers of content are actually revealing their sources and their data sources. So when we're creating content on the web, I think it's really important to be thinking about citations, providing citations and references for the information that we're using to compile those articles. So, you know, for example, we base an article around a set of data we've discovered elsewhere on the web, then referencing that and even particularly linking out within the content piece to that original data set so that users can go and check the information that we're talking about and that we're building a whole article and argument around. So perhaps, again, linking out to other spaces on the web that verify the information you're giving is potentially a good trust indicator. Your methods for creating content, and clearly this kind of relates again to sort of news-focused content. You know, why you pursued certain topics, why you're interested in certain topics, what was the process, again, of putting together content potentially is important. In terms of locally sourced content, again, clearly this is talking about sort of local news. But I think it does kind of raise the question of sort of local expertise and local expertise potentially when we're talking about those expertise, authority and trust signals, expertise at a local level being important. Kind of what that means is if you're kind of particularly well known in a particular region or marketplace and you start to try and expand, you're potentially going to have to start to try and build up those same signals of expertise and authority in different locations if you want that content to rank in the same way that it does in the location you're better known than you or used to represent it. Diverse voices, you know, when you're compiling content, are you kind of providing balanced arguments? Are you pulling information and data from different sort of sides of the argument and the debate? You know, are you giving opportunities for different voices to express their opinions within that? We don't want to be giving sort of one-sided or stereotypical sort of views on particular issues or groups of people, etc., within our content. Finally, within this final point is actionable feedback. You know, users are being told that it's more likely that they can trust content where they're able to provide feedback, and the provider of that content will actually listen to that and take that feedback on board. So again, when we've got content, we've got things like blogs, where we have the option potentially to take comments from users, that potentially can be a positive thing. We can give positive trust signals. The implications around that whether or not we've got the resources to police feedback on content and manage that and edit it, but potentially it's positive if we can do that. Okay, so just to summarize kind of what we've been through within this session, first of all, talked about the fact Google's not making subjective assessments of quality on the web, of your particular web pages. Quality is assessed by user signals, user feedback and data, and by signals correlating to that expertise, authoritativeness, and trustworthiness. We need to demonstrate our expertise through content, developing lots of good content around our topic. Backlinks are a significant signal in establishing authoritativeness and trust for our web pages. So we need to continue to work to try and gain links to our sites and our pages. We need to help users understand who we are as a brand, why they should trust us. And in particular, if we're working in those areas that Google may be looking at as your money or your life content, we're going to have to work even harder to establish our credibility in those particular topics and niches. And specifically working in the news and editorial space, are we transparent about our intentions and our methods to represent rounded, balanced content and arguments within it? So that basically brings me to a close, brings presentation part of this to a close. So at this point, I'd like to ask if anybody has any questions. So raise any questions in your mind, any sort of feedback, anything you want to say about the things discussed in this session, do please feel free. Just going to have a quick look at the chat and just see if anybody did drop in any questions during the session. Looks like they didn't. So anybody who's still with me, any questions from that? Anybody want to raise any points or ask any questions? Just, you know, feel free, you can drop any questions into the chat, or feel free at this stage to unmute yourselves and ask me a question directly.
Hi, Chris. It's Kumar.
Hi, Kumar.
Just a quick comment. A really great presentation and training. I appreciate it. One thing I was thinking about, the user experience. Google is always saying that the site should load fast. The user should have great experience on the site, all these factors, you know, technical side, how important they are, and if Google has to choose between a technically optimized site and a well-known brand site, what would they prefer?
Yeah, great question. Definitely technical factors are really important. They're kind of important signals. We haven't talked about so much in the context of this presentation because it's been more focused around weeding out disinformation, promoting sort of accurate content, where those signals don't apply quite so much. But generally, in terms of SEO, yeah, technical factors are really important. So as you mentioned, page speed, not just the speed at which pages load, but whether or not the users can interact quickly with those pages is really important. The structure and crawlability of our web pages, lots of technical factors that go into that. Mobile usability and the functionality for mobile users is really important. Really, really tough question to answer. Which is Google seeing as being the most important? Because they work together, okay? And the technical factors are, you know, the real foundations for your website. Your website needs to be functioning well to rank well. So, you know, given that most of us are probably working in relatively competitive spaces, we really need to focus on all of these things, and they work in partnership. You know, if we've just got a website that's got great content, but it loads really slowly and doesn't give a good user experience, then we're not going to perform that well. Conversely, we can have a site that kind of is really fit, it works really well, it's lightning fast, but if the content isn't up to scratch, then we're not going to perform well either. So, apologies if I'm dodging the question slightly, but that's just because I don't think you can kind of isolate individual elements with SEO really. Clearly, when you're kind of looking at individual websites, I was like consulting with a particular brand, I might be able to identify where we thought the weaknesses and strengths were within that website, and then we might focus on one of those areas or another, depending on what we were seeing. But if you're just starting out, then you kind of really need to focus on all those elements, basically. So apologies if that's a bit vague, but you know, essentially all things work together really in tandem. Does that give you a reasonably satisfactory answer to that, Colin?
Yeah, that definitely makes sense. Like it's not just one factor, it's multiple, and all all should be taken care of. But I was just thinking, like, as I also mentioned in the chat for my introduction, I work with the United Nations, the UN Refugee Agency. And if we say that we are known brand, and we hope that people or users just gonna get over content in the search results, that's not gonna happen. So we have to really put more effort in terms of, you know, as you also mentioned, the competition.
I mean, it does really come down, as you say, to the brand. You know, the advantage in your situation is, as a sort of an international sort of governmental style organization, you are going to have authority behind you from the start. So one of the things you're not going to have to work so hard around probably is building up those authority signals. You know, you probably naturally have a lot of links pointing from other really authoritative sources, government websites, for example. So, you know, in your particular case, that's probably one area you're not going to have to work as hard on. But yeah, technical factors or, you know, developing content and content signals, you bats are. So yeah, horses for courses to a degree. Anybody else with any questions? Please feel free to jump in. No, if not, we can draw the session to a close, but I'm quite happy just to give you a sec to think if you've got anything else you want to ask or any comments. Feel free to disagree with anything I've said today, I don't mind. Happy to have a conversation and debate. But if not, we will bring things to a close. Allow me out a slight kind of little sales pitch at the end, just if you have enjoyed the session today, you are interested more in some of the topics we've discussed, obviously Jellyfish training, self-training courses, feel free to come and look out the things we do on our web pages. Also, if you do happen to think of any questions you want to ask afterwards, I'm always quite happy for you to reach out to me. So you see my email address on screen there, chris.hudsey@jellyfish. Don't mind you contacting me via email. Or also feel free to reach out on LinkedIn, connect on LinkedIn. And if anybody wants to contact me afterwards, please feel free to do so. But other than that, I will thank you for joining me today. And thanks for sticking with me. Hope that's been useful for you, giving you some food for thought. But yeah, essentially, thanks very much and enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you.